This is Sean from Pro MMA Now, and I'm here with longtime friend Rich Franklin. Rich, how are you?
I'm doing real well. How are you, bud?
I'm doing great. So you're out there in sunny California, right?
I am.
Well, we talked earlier, and you said it was surprisingly in the 40s.
Yeah, we've had this cold front come through. Everybody thinks when you're in California that it's just real warm and all that kind of stuff, and then I hate talking about cold weather to my friends and family here in Ohio when I'm out here, because they're like, oh, it must be terrible. It's in the 40s when we just had like a foot of snow drop on us a couple days ago. But it's just at that temperature where you look outside, it's sunny, you're in California, and you think, oh, I'm good. I'll just throw on a pair of shorts and a t-shirt or even just like a light jacket. And then when you go outside, it's like you're not dressed for the warm or for the cold. It's just cold enough that you always feel cold out here because you're not dressed properly.
So do you go out and run when it's that cold?
Honestly, Sean, I mean, I'll do a little bit of running here and there, but I don't run a whole lot if I'm not getting ready for a fight. When I'm out here in California, the one thing I do like doing is sprint work at the beach in the sand, because it's not as jolting for the body and all that kind of stuff.
When you go out there, I just got to ask, because this is, especially in California, MMA was huge out there. Well, obviously Midwest it was, but when you hit the beach, do you pick a place that's secluded, or you just pick the first place you can find? Because I'm sure you get, oh my God, it's Rich Franklin.
No, actually, there's this place, like, for instance, I rarely just go to the beach and hang out. Like, I have too many things to do to just sit on the sand and think about how I can just spend my day doing nothing. when I go to the beach, like, there's this workout area over here near Santa Monica Pier with these ropes and rings and all this stuff. Like, they have these, like, military-style ropes. So I'll go over there and I'll climb the ropes and do pull-ups and push-ups on the parallel bars and dips and all that kind of stuff. Like, and, you know, typically, like, I'm there with some workout partners and do some sprints in the sand and running and things like that. So just, like, a little cross-training type of workout. And, people run into me all the time there. They're like, man, this is crazy. I just can't believe I'm running into you here. And most people, though, you know, they'll say hello and then they'll let you be. They understand you're working out. They're usually working out too, and it's not that big of a problem.
Well, I know a lot of people don't know. I mean, you're one of the guys I can say that truly loves his state, and you always supported it, and you're always trying to build MMA in Ohio. What took you out to California? I know it had something to do with business, right?
Yeah. Well, I'm not here 100% full-time either. I'm back and forth between home and California. You just happen to catch me at the time when I'm out here. I'm building a business out here. I opened up an organic juice bar in Beverly Hills on 252 South Beverly Drive out here, just in the heart of Beverly Hills. And working on a second location and currently looking for a third location.
Wow.
And it's just something that I'm doing out here. So during this building phase, I've been spending a little bit of time out here, but this is, you know, I wouldn't say that I've 100% completely abandoned my Midwest roots.
Right. So what's it like? I mean, obviously Beverly Hills, you know, that's one of the most popular places on the planet, and it's in the movies all the time. When you first showed up at Beverly Hills, were you underwhelmed or overwhelmed, or what was your initial feeling?
Well, okay, so I guess here's the best way to put it. I'm from the Midwest. I carry a pocket knife in my pocket, and quite frankly, I'm that guy. I'm a Midwest guy. I do a lot of the things that Midwesterners are known for doing. And, one day I had a pocket knife in my pocket and somebody needed to open, like, a box or something like that. And I pulled out my pocket knife to cut the tape to open it, and they looked at me like I was a weirdo, like the weirdest guy they could ever seen for having a pocket knife. They even said something like, you're carrying a knife? And I said, well, it's just a little pocket knife. And they're like, you put it to knife. And I'm like, and it came in handy. The point is, I said to this person, I said, it's crazy. I said, because I'm carrying a pocket knife, I'm the weirdo in a land where people walk their kids on leashes and carry their dogs.
I love California, but every time I go there, which I haven't been there in quite a while, but when I would go there, I would see the weirdest things, people with the weirdest fashions. But a Midwest guy shows up with a pocket knife, and all, you know, it's like a big shock. You know, it's probably like a scandal, you know?
Yeah, it's just, you know, it really is just, it's, when you come out here, I've spent some time in California for days at a time here and there throughout my career. When you come out here for days at a time, like, you know, nothing really seems different. But when you're in the mix of things for a while, you really start noticing that being from a different part of the country, like the Midwest or something like that, you truly are different than a lot of the people that are out here.
So you've got one open, and you were talking about open a second and a third. I mean, it must be going well.
We've been open for 3 weeks now, our first location, and we opened at the absolute worst possible time of the year for, like, the food industry during Christmas, especially healthy food, because people will start their New Year's resolutions at the beginning of the year. But as anticipated, when you open a business, you know, sales are not stellar on day one, but each day we're upward trending, and things are looking in a positive direction, and we have a great business plan. Myself and my business partner, his name is Billy Zeeby, just have a great business plan, and so I have a lot of faith in this. I have to have a lot of faith in it because I'm using what I need fighting to kind of roll into this. This is what will carry me through and pay my bills when I'm retired.
You know, for those of you who are listening to this interview who don't know Billy Zeeby, he has been around the game for a long time. I met him back when I first started announcing, and he's just a great guy. And Rich, that doesn't surprise me to hear you associated with that name because, I mean, he's pretty much, his stomping grounds was the Midwest at some of the shows I would see him. I mean, I haven't talked to him in forever, so you definitely have a good business partner there.
Well, thank you. I'll let him know that.
I appreciate it. And now I want to switch gears a little bit because you've got all of this going on. Let's say, I don't know, Rich, have you got spoken about a fight potentially to Joe Silva or anybody in the UFC?
No, I have not. Actually, my original business plan, we wanted to be open by, what was our initial opening date? I can't even remember, but the point is that we got pushed back, dealing with a lot of things with the city of LA, Beverly Hills in particular, and stuff like that, and it was more difficult to get open than we thought. And long story short, that's kind of, it pushed back the time frame in which I was going to negotiate for fights with the UFC.
Right.
So if you would have asked me, if we were having this interview like 6 months ago, I would have thought that I probably would have been fighting before the end of this year. And then as the year developed and I realized that this business that I opened just needed a little bit more of my attention and care than I had initially thought, or that the time frame was pushed back, I realized like it wasn't going to happen by the end of the year. So at this point, I haven't had any talks or negotiations with the UFC about my next fight, only because I really have to make sure that the business is running smoothly before I kind of let go of the reins and let the people that we've hired just run with it. And so, you know, again, asking me this question now, I'd say sometime around early to mid next year is what I'm thinking. But I'm going to have to, at this point in time, I'm going to have to get back into, I'm training, but I need to get back into a regular training regimen for a little while before I actually begin my fight prep.
I mean, there are so many good fight teams out there in California and around there. Is that where you would probably train? Or would you go back to Ohio? I mean, in your head, where do you envision training?
Honestly, Sean, that's a great question and one that I really don't have an answer to because I can't imagine for the last fight of my career being out here in California and just starting with basically a whole new camp.
Right.
I've been with the same guys. I've been with, you know, everybody's seen them in my corner, George Gershon. Rozelle, Rob Radford, Neil Rowe, Mike Ferguson, my strength and training coach. And then I've had some, I did a stint with Matt Hume for a while.
Right.
So I really don't know. I really don't know what I would do. I mean, I thought, would I want to start a camp here in California? I'm not sure that would be the best. I know that's not the best idea. Working with guys that have familiarity with you, guys that know when you're overtrained, you guys that know what you're capable of and how to tailor game plans to your style and all that kind of stuff is the smartest decision that you make. So that's still going to require some decision making on my end.
Right, and I'm going to talk one other thing. I think you are a prime example. I mean, I met you just before the Ken Shamrock fight, and you are a prime example of someone whose hard work obviously has paid off. I remember back then it was you and George, and I would come up there and there'd be some guys coming in like Marcus Davis, Joe Riggs, and things like that. But now, I mean, talking to you now, you've been in films, you're opening businesses, you've got the website. Can you talk to us about the status of the website?
Which website do you want to know about?
The nutrition website that launched, I think it was maybe a year ago, I talked to you about.
Yeah, it was a little over a year ago. We did launched Ace's Way, and then a couple of the gentlemen that were behind this project, just when we launched it, like, things started taking off really well in the direction that we wanted it to go into. And then we kind of, it was just a busy time with my fight career. I couldn't commit the time that I needed to.
Right.
To that website, and nor could they. So things were kind of, I guess the website had like a subpar performance, so we basically stepped back away from it for a little while, and now we're starting to really push that because it really connects well with the juice company that I'm opening here in Los
right.
Angeles.
It makes sense. I mean, that's one of the reasons I asked, because if you've never visited Ace's Way, you need to, because I've lost 16 pounds, and for reference, I had printed some things out, some articles that Rich had written, and it will help you if you're worried about nutrition or anything. You need to go to Ace's Way or sites like that. And the juice bar, Rich, are you planning on putting out like information, maybe a book or anything on the benefits of juice and stuff like that?
If I'll actually write a book. We put out a lot of information through articles on Ace's Way. Some of that will also be offered on, and I don't know if I actually said the name of the juice bar earlier, Zeelin, Z-E-L-I-N. A lot of that will be offered on, like, through Zeelin's media as well, like maybe the Facebook and stuff like that, our website for Zeelin. Like, I'm sure we'll probably cross-promote. Since Ace's Way is a nutritional website, we'll probably, if we write an article for Ace's Way, it'll probably get cross-promoted on Zeelin when it applies to juicing or the other products that we have in the store, because we're not just a juice, like a juicing restaurant. There are many other things that we offer. But yeah, I would imagine that at some point in time, we'll probably end up writing, like, e-books.
Okay.
Or something like that that can be offered on Ace's Way. I don't know. And listen, I don't know, Sean. I really don't know if like writing a published hardback or paperback book about nutrition is in the future for me or not. Because it's easy to put out shorter ebooks, but to commit to, a long, intensive physical book is a lot of work. So at this point in time, like, my focus is shifted towards Zeelin and the juice bar and the cafe that I have. But the book would require a lot of attention. So until I get to the point where I have the time for something like that, it's not in the immediate future.
Okay, I do have just a few more questions, and one of them is, back in the day, nutrition wasn't something that was widely, I guess there wasn't information and experts widely available, because quite honestly, eat a bunch of protein, bulk up, but now it's almost, seriously, I consider some of the nutrition technology, just, human technology, the way that you can guide the way your body goes. And So the older you get, there is a better chance, you know, that you won't have to go up in weight classes. Would you agree with me that older guys are still able to make their weight classes because of the evolution of nutrition?
You mean for cutting weight and stuff like that?
Yeah, I mean, look at Randy Couture. I mean, I'm sure he's not, like, the biggest guy, but, I mean, he was still making, you know, 205 into his 40s.
Yeah. Well, I think Randy doesn't really, you take me, for example. I'm not a really big guy. I walk around maybe, right now I'm probably about 210, and this will probably end up being the weight that I settle in on for the rest of my life, like between 210 and maybe 215. Maybe over the years I'll be able to put on a couple pounds of muscle if I continue eating properly and working out the way that I should. But for the most part, like, this is it. And so for me to make 185, well, if I start, like, even 10 years from now, if I said, you know what, I want to make 185 just to prove that I can, it's just about, like, working out the way that I would for a fight, like, you know, that kind of output and all that. Because for me, like, my nutrition, it stays the same, whether I'm fighting or whether I'm not fighting, like, it's the same. And I'm one of the athletes that really, really understands that you can have a little bit of cheat food here and there, and it's not going to damage you that bad, but you can't just fall off the wagon when you're not prepping for a fight. So people ask me, like, well, what do you eat when you're getting ready for a fight? I eat the same things I eat when I'm not getting ready for a fight. As a matter of fact, this morning, this is typical of me, but as we were doing this interview, Sean, I was sitting here drinking not a juice that I made, but I actually blended it in a blender instead because I maintain all my fiber. But it was a combination of kale, mint, parsley, broccoli, and grapefruit. That's what I had this morning for my green drink. Wow. And then I'll have, like, maybe some egg whites or something like that here in a little bit.
Yeah, and I always joke with Rich and tell him he eats like a raisin skin, a lemon rind, and a piece of lettuce and a glass of air, because after one of Rich's fights, I went up and visited him, and he was with George, and I came in the back, and Rich was pinching literally like 1 centimeter of excess fat and said, God, I'm really out of shape. And I just remember that set the tone for how I view you, or how I viewed you through the years, as literally the guy who, if I was ever in dire need, my life depended on it, and I needed nutrition, I would go to you, because I don't think I've ever seen you, Rich, ever out of shape. If you have a picture of that, I would love to see it.
It doesn't exist. You got to remember, Sean, I came from, in high school, I was the skinny kid. So I've never been an overweight guy, but I have been underweight to the point that I know what it feels like. Like, for people that are overweight, when you look at yourself and you don't like the way that you look, or you get made fun of or something like that, like, I know the feeling just on the opposite end of the spectrum. I was the kid that was so skinny that I looked like I was sick, or I got made fun of for being just bones and skin type of thing. So, but, you know, skinny people never look, quote unquote, out of shape. So, I've never had that out of shape look. And plus, fitness, sports, nutrition, it's been a part of my life. All that's been a part of my life since I was in high school. It's not, you're never going to really see me out of shape. I mean, the day where I don't look like I'm in fight shape anymore, but even still, I'll be lean. I'm sure that you'll be able to see my six pack and that kind of stuff, just because of the way that I eat. I constantly eat clean.
Well, you answered my second to last question, which is where you would fight at, and it was 185. The last question I have for you, Rich, so we've been going almost 20 minutes here, and obviously when you're a Rich Franklin, you're busy, and I appreciate your time. The last question is, would you ever consider a role as, say, a commentator like a Chael Sonnen or Rashad Evans on Fox Sports 1 or anything like that?
It just depends. Look, that it's not, when I sit and think about it, it's not my dream job. That wouldn't be my passion, so to speak. But it just all depends. They film out here in LA, and if I don't want to make LA my permanent residence, then I'm stuck commuting to LA once every however, whatever the duration they need me for. And so then you got to ask yourself, like, is it worth getting on a plane and flying and all this kind of stuff, like, say, once a week, for example. And And so I would consider doing it. I enjoyed doing it the first time, but my passion is nutrition, and that's why I've been working on this juice bar and stuff.
All right. Pro MMA Now, talking to Rich Franklin. Rich, we really appreciate your time, and as soon as you find out about your fight, we'd love to talk to you about it.
Awesome. Good, buddy.
All right. Take it easy, Rich.
Yeah. Talk to you later.
All right. Bye.